I know the Lord will lead and guide us all the way. Hallelujah. Our scripture lesson today is coming from the book of Psalm 51, and we're going to begin at the 10th verse. And it reads, create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me from your presence or take your Holy Spirit from me. It goes on to say, restore to me the joy of your salvation and grant me with a willing spirit to sustain me. Blessed be the word of God.
Let us pray. O thou in whose presence our soul takes delight, on whom in affliction we call, our comfort by day, our song in the night, our hope, our salvation, our all. It's Maurice again, Lord, and I've come with a few friends. Before we ask you for anything, we want to thank you for everything. Thank you for this day. Thank you for your goodness, your grace, your love, your mercy, your kindness. Thank you because every time we turn around, you're always making a way. Thank you that we can feel the sunshine. Thank you that we can feel the wind blow. Thank you, God, for all that you have done. God, we just come to tell you thank you. God, we won't ask you to stop by because you were here when we got here. But we will ask you to have your way tonight. Have your way in this place. Have your way tonight, Lord. Do whatever you feel like doing. We yield ourselves to your will. Have your way tonight. Let the power of the Holy Spirit move in this place. God, we thank you for what you've done. We thank you for what you're going to do. God, we ask that you would touch us in a mighty way. Lord, we recognize we can do nothing without you. So tonight we admit we need you. We need you in our lives. We need you in our homes. And we need you in this church. Let your will be done. Then God, tonight we ask that you would bless your servant that will break the bread of life, dip them way down in your storehouse, bring them up fresh and anointed, that he might stand and make the proclamation of your word. Then, Lord, we pray that we would hear the word. Not just be hearers, but, Lord, that we would be doers of the word. So tonight we ask you to have your way. Look upon us with your favor. Look upon us with your care. Hear our prayer. This we ask in Jesus' name. And every heart said amen.
the church say amen? Amen. The Greater Huntsville Interdenominational Ministers Fellowship welcomes this community and this preacher to Revival 2017. We are a fellowship made up of many denominations, diverse churches, and a broad spectrum of ministers. But in here, we are one. Will all the members of the Greater Interdenominational Ministers Fellowship please stand? Thank you. Rodney King asked a question a few years ago, can we all get along? Who would have thought that we would be where we are right now? Political solutions have been tried. Economic solutions have been tried. Legal issues have been tried, and they all have essentially failed. But the Church of Jesus Christ has an answer. And that answer is that if there is authentic growing relationship with Christ, we can come together and work together and to love each other and to get along. And to that end, we've come to preach Jesus. Amen? Amen. We've come to affirm that he still changes lives. That he still breaks the barriers in people's lives. He is able to set captives free and to bless his people. Why don't you say amen? Amen. And it is his love that constrains us to get out of our comfort zone. It is his love that constrains us to break the barrier that separates us. It is his love that causes us to overcome things, to forget things, to turn our back on certain things so that we can get along and love each other. So tonight we invite you to participate with the Holy Spirit and the Word of God as the preacher brings the Word to us so that he may call us afresh to the ministry of reconciliation. Amen? Amen. That's what the Lord's all about. He's about bringing us back to him and bringing us to each other so that we can be together in the bonds of love. Won't you participate tonight with the Holy Spirit as he not only calls us to the ministry of reconciliation, but to the high calling of servanthood and the priority of the kingdom. I believe the word of God is still real today, that if we seek the kingdom first, then if we seek him as a priority in our lives first, he'll take care of the rest. Amen? Amen. So tonight we're about kingdom business. We're not about church business. We're about kingdom business. We're not about denominational business. But we're about kingdom business. We're not even about black business. We're about kingdom business. For the kingdom is better than any of those things, and he shall establish his kingdom in our hearts. Amen. Amen. Welcome you tonight as we share with us tonight as God leads our hearts and our spirits to a higher level this week as we share the ministry of Jesus Christ. Why don't you say amen? Amen.
Again, all the saints said amen.
Amen.
How good the Lord is on tonight. Amen. He truly has been better to us than we have been to ourselves. Amen. I am a proud member of this fellowship. This fellowship is blessed of multiple denominations to make a difference in this community. Not only do we sponsor this revival, but we sponsor the NAACP, the Huntsville Bible College, the Huntsville Housing Program. And that's not possible without giving, because anybody here that knows ministry requires money. Somebody ought to say amen. And so if you've been blessed tonight, I want to invite you to bless this fellowship, to bless this city through this fellowship in your giving. We ask that you would be liberal as the Lord has so prospered you that you might bless others. If you would, every head bowed, every eye closed. Eternal God, we thank you for being God. We thank you for this another expression of your goodness and your kindness. We pray, God, that you would touch our hearts and our minds and allow us to give back a portion of what you have already blessed us with. We ask that you would multiply it for the good of your kingdom. We ask all this right now in the strong and sufficient name of Jesus, our Savior. And we do pray. And the people of God who love God said amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Just now the ushers shall come.
Amen. Let's give the Lord thanks again for this wonderful praise dance ministry. Give God praise for this music ministry tonight. Amen. So glad that all of you have come tonight on this first night of this citywide revival. In the midst of all that we are experiencing in this country and in this world, as Andre Crouch once said, we need to hear from you. We need a word from you. If we don't hear from you, Lord, what will we do? Wanting you more each day, show us your perfect way. We need to hear from you because there's no other way for us to live than to hear from the Lord. At every interval of history, God births, calls, and commissions prophetic voices to speak on his behalf, not just to those who are called by his name, but to the whole world. Amidst all the muck of sinfulness and the mire of stubbornness, God is never without a voice that announces his good, acceptable, and perfect will. And aren't you glad that God loves us so much that he would not leave us without the knowledge of his will? Beginning tonight, we are especially blessed to have another one of those in the long list and legacy of prophetic voices. I guess evangelists, he's well prepared. He received his formal education in academic institutions of higher learning at Bishop College in Dallas, Trinity Theological Seminary in Newburgh, Indiana, Liberty Theological Seminary in Lynchburg, Virginia, St. Thomas Christian College in Jacksonville, Florida, and is currently pursuing a terminal degree in Anderson, South Carolina. He's prepared. But I guess evangelist is also pastoral. He has many years of successful pastoral experience, beginning in 1976 in Texas, where he served for more than 9 years as pastor. And now he serves as the proud pastor of the Zion Hope Primitive Baptist Church, serving there since 1985 in Pensacola, Florida. Pensacola, where he once went to have church picnics from his home church, but now God has sent him there to labor in that part of the Moore Vineyard. I guess evangelist is prepared and pastoral, but he's also president. In addition to have the many years of pastoral experience, many years of denominational leadership, as Bible expositor and moderator, having served as vice president of the National Primitive Baptist Convention, USA, from 2005 to 2011, he now serves as the general president of the National Primitive Baptist Convention, USA. That tenure began in 2011 and continues unto this day. This servant of God aspires to make a difference. He aspires to help other clergy in their training. One of his presidential initiatives as general president has been to develop partnerships with urban ministries out of Chicago and with Huntsville Bible College right here in Huntsville, in order that other clergy might be trained and laity to serve this present age. But saints and friends, let me just include something else tonight. Back home, we'd say we're really among tall cotton, because tonight we're in the midst of two distinguished national presidents. Our host pastor, the Reverend Dr. Julius R. Scruggs, the past president of the National Baptist Convention. Let's give God praise for him. And I guess the evangelist, I present to you tonight the Reverend Dr. Bernard C. Yates. I guess the evangelist prepared and pastoral, president, community involved locally and nationally and internationally. He's a family man married to his wife, Bonda, for 35 years, and they're blessed with a daughter whose birthday, he said, is today. She's 29 years old today. He has a son-in-law, and he has two grandchildren who are the apple of his eyes.
They have the keys to his, to their grandparents' hearts, but also the keys to their finances. They love them dearly. He talked about them today. My brothers and sisters, it's my distinct pleasure and honor tonight to do what they do when those presidents walk into the room. Presidents are duly elected as presidents of these United States. When they walk into the room, the audience immediately stands. And so I want to ask you to please stand right now as a token of our genuine Huntsville, Madison County, Tennessee Valley, welcoming, praying, ready to listen to the word of God. Can somebody just shout hallelujah? Amen. We are ready to hear the word. Dr. Bernard C. Yates, we welcome you to Huntsville, Madison County, and to the Tennessee Valley. Let's give God praise for what God has prepared for us.
The we pray. God, we thank you tonight for this wonderful privilege to worship you in the beauty of holiness, that we may serve you to the glory of your name and for the inspiration of mankind. We thank you for the privilege to come to this place, and during this time of revival, we pray your blessings upon this gathering, these evenings that we share together. We pray that you will anoint your word fresh. Let it not return unto you void, but let it accomplish what it is set to accomplish. Give your servant the tongue of the learned, that I may know how to speak a word in season for those who are weary. Most of all, have your way. It's our prayer. In the strong and perfect name of Jesus, we pray, amen.
Amen.
And all the people said amen again.
Amen.
It's great to be here. We give God the praise and honor to him who's able to do all things well. To thank you, Dr. Walker, president of this Greater Huntsville Interdenominational Ministers Fellowship, to Pastor Davidson, the vice president. And it's with great pleasure and honor that I acknowledge the angel of this house, Dr. Julius Scruggs, and to all of my fellow ministers, pastors, those in the pulpit, those in the pew. It's good to be here. It's been a while, but I thank God for once again the invitation to come to be a part of this great ministerial fellowship as you lead out in citywide revival. I'm thankful that the Lord has spared me and brought us over the miles, the skyways, to be here. Somebody asked, how was your flight? Did you have a good flight? Any flight that lands.
Yes, sir.
You know, I ain't excited about how well you can fly. I just want to see if you can take off and if you can land. I'm grateful to be here. I thank God for the graciousness of this president and for all of you who made this possible for us to be here. And so revival, of course, is for those who are alive. Sometimes we appear lifeless. So we need to occasionally stop the work so we can work on what makes the work go. And revival is wonderful. It's a wonderful privilege of the church. God said he would revive us. He said, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, he said, then will I hear them from heaven, and I'll forgive their sins, and I'll heal their land. And how many know our land needs healing? Wow, we need healing. But God ain't looking for the White House to pray. He's not looking for the Congress or the House of Representatives to pray. He said, if my people... That's us. He said, who are called by my name would humble themselves and pray. He said, I will hear them from heaven. He'll forgive our sins and he'll heal our land. And so I'm grateful to be an agent for revival. And we thank God for your open heart. And I pray you pray for me, pray with me this week, that I might speak the words that God will have me to speak to your heart. Turn with me, if you will, tonight to the book of Luke, chapter 17. Luke's Gospel, chapter 17. I want to look at verses 17, 18, and 19 for our text. Heed the word of the Lord. One of them, when he saw, I'm reading from the NIV, my Bible may read a little different from yours, same word. One of them, when he saw he was healed, came back praising God in a loud voice. He threw himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him, and he was a Samaritan. Jesus asked, were there not 10 cleansed? He said, were there not 10 cleansed? Where are the other 9? Has no one returned to give praise to God except this foreigner? Then he said to him, rise and go. Your faith has made you well. This is the word of the Lord. Jesus asked, were not all 10 cleansed? Where are the 9? Has no one returned to give praise to God except this foreigner? Yeah. I want to use for subject how to have a truly thankful heart. How to have a truly thankful heart. You know, when I was a child, I want to confess that I owned absolutely nothing. Nothing that I could claim possession of was mine by ownership. Not my shoes, not my clothes, not my bed, not my shelter. Because common sense tells you that if you didn't buy it, then it's not yours. Doesn't belong to you. So as a child, I played, I walked around, I went to school, church, with my parents' stuff on. My pants didn't belong to me. My jeans didn't belong to me. Those Chuck Taylors I had on didn't belong to me. Even my underwear didn't belong to me. My Sunday suits, my school shoes or Sunday shoes did not belong to me. In fact, because it was theirs, or maybe I'll say hers, if she wanted me to take them off at any time, she had the right to do it. And matter of fact, a couple of times when I got a little beside myself, she did say, take my stuff off. Why? Because in this country, anything you pay for is yours. So since they paid for it, therefore it was theirs. Once my brothers and I decided to do something nice for Mom and Dad on their birthday, which were both in September, we made a sacrifice and saved every piece of change we could and brought joy to our parents' heart that year in September by giving them a birthday gift from us. It went well. The only problem was we did it with their money. And they acted like it was ours. But in all actuality, they had underwritten that birthday party. Well, in the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray, there are two components. There's a subjective, there's an objective and a subjective. Objective is directed toward God. Subjective is earth. objective. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Subjective, give us this day our daily bread. You know, I believe the most used component of prayer is the subjective. Yes. It's the prayer petition. Yes. Give us this day. Sometimes we say, give us this day our daily bread before we say our Father. That's when we place our needs before Almighty God and ask Him to supply them. But very often, my brothers and sisters, we fail to express our gratitude and our gratefulness to God for what we have received. And so we ought not just pray prayers of petition, but we ought to pray also prayers of thanksgiving. There ought to be some praise in our prayer. You remember the question of the psalmist. He says, what shall I render unto the Lord for all of his benefits? And then he offers a couple of things that he gives us a little short list. He said, I can do to show my appreciation to God. He said, I can pay my vows in the presence of his people. I can pay my tithes when I come to church. Yeah. Or secondly, he said, I can drink the cup of salvation and call upon the name of the Lord. He said, he gives us two things that we can at least do to render unto the God and render unto the Lord for all of his benefit. But if the truth be told, come on, if the truth were told, there's very little that you and I can give back to God for his goodness and his mercy toward us. Since we believe that he is the creator of all things visible and invisible, since we believe that everything James says in this verse is true, every good and every perfect gift cometh down from above from the Father of lights, in him there is no darkness nor shadow of turning, it stands to reason that anything we give to God, we're only returning that which he has given to us. He's underwriting everything we're doing, because everything he blesses us with is only what we go get, what he gives us in return for his goodness. It is not our money. It's God's money. It's not our resources that we give to him. It's God's resources. It's not our time. It's God's time. It's not our service. It's God's service. It's not our energy. It's God's energy. It's not our opportunities. It's God's opportunities. None of it belongs to us. Hallelujah. The prophet Haggai helps us along these lines. He said, the silver is mine, and the gold is mine, says the Lord of hosts. Job helps us out here. He said, we brought nothing into this world, and it is certain that we can carry nothing out. The Lord has given, and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. So we came into the world empty-handed, and according to Job, we're going to leave it all here, and we don't need a U-Haul following our hearse. You don't need a wardrobe of suits or outfits, because you're going to only need one. And somebody else is going to pick that one for you. Then I feel safe in saying what we have is not really ours. And you ought to agree with me that even your life is on loan. Help me, somebody. Moses said in the 90th Psalm, he said, the days of our years are 70 years. And if by reason of strength they be 80, yet there is labor and sorrow, we're soon cut off. We fly away. And so the question becomes then, is there anything, is there any gift, is there any offering that we can give to God that may be regarded as our own? Well, Clement of Alexander, one of the early church fathers, says this. He says, The only offering we can give to God is a thankful heart. Yes, sir. When it all boils down to what we can actually give that he will appreciate more than anything, Clement says, a thankful heart. And so this New Testament miracle, this wonderful miracle, reveals a man, you know it all too well, reveals a man with that kind of heart, a truly thankful heart.
All right.
And we can recall in the text, Jesus healed, remember, 10 lepers. They dwelled on the outside of the camp because they were not fit to go inside. They were divided from their families. They were taken from their homes because of the contagious disease of leprosy. Yeah. Jesus walks into the city. They hollers at him and said, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. And he tells them immediately, go show yourself to the priest. And the Bible says, as they went, they were healed. Looked at their hands looked new. Looked at their feet, and they did too. Jesus healed 10 lepers, but only one of them returned to say thank you. To which Jesus answers in verse 17, were not 10 cleansed? Where are the 9? I'm guilty, brothers and sisters, of spending an inordinate amount of time dealing with the 9 who didn't come back. Or shall I say 90% that don't show that they're thankful. And I can easily do that tonight, but I'm not going to do that because tonight I'm more concerned with the one who came back to give thanks than with the 9 who did not. It's his heart, my brothers and sisters, that I want to examine to see just what kind of heart is a truly thankful heart. It's right here in the text. The text teaches us, first of all, that a thankful heart is a thoughtful heart. It's because there's no coincidence that the word thank comes from the same root as think. So to be thankless is to be thoughtless. See, and we see this principle fleshed out in our children. And I'm not talking about nobody else's child. I'm just going to reflect on my own home training. Growing up in the home of Robert and Maggie Yates, I can remember whenever my mother or some adult would give us something, we would take the gift, and just as we were about to walk away, Mama would say, what do you say?
All right.
Then I would say a subdued and hardly audible, thank you. Because in my heart, thank you was an afterthought. I mean, you can agree that you don't have to teach a child to lie. Sometimes they start lying as soon as they can talk. Come on, somebody. You don't have to teach a child to cuss. As sweet and as innocent as they look, they can string together some major expletives and can outcuss any grown person. Come on, somebody. But because of their lack of maturity, you got to teach them to say thank you. Because a glaring effect of immaturity is thoughtlessness. How many know you can be thankful but not thoughtful? But wait, when you look at the text, you can discover that children are not the only ones who can be thoughtless. In this text, 9 grown folks were thoughtless. 9 adults were thoughtless. Now, only 1 grown person returned to express gratitude. When all of them, let me give a good word for them, all of them undoubtedly to some degree felt thankful, but 9 decided that they weren't going to say nothing, they weren't going to come back. Sounds like church in Florida. Help me somebody. 90% of the folk that are blessed are the ones that have something else to do when the army of the Lord is gathering. Only the adults returned, 1 adult returned to express gratitude when all of them undoubtedly to some degree may have felt it. But listen, a thoughtful saint, beloved, goes further than feeling. A thoughtful saint goes beyond expressing thankfulness in my heart. Oh, he know I'm thankful. He know. Jesus knows I'm grateful. God's been good to me all my life. I understand that. But every now and then, it appears to me that somebody ought to show it in some way. Have I got a witness? Thoughtful saints go further than feeling thankful. They understand that thankfulness and real gratefulness is expressed not just in my feeling, but to somebody who is the object and the source of my supply. They know that gratitude, do you know gratitude ought to be expressed? Help me somebody. It not only should be expressed, but it should be expressed to somebody. Help me somebody. Somebody, some way, sometime. I know we feel grateful sometimes. I know in our hearts we don't want the Lord to know that we're not grateful. But every now and then he gives us a chance to do it by pressing our way to the house of God and giving God some humble and obedient thanks for the many blessings that he has bestowed upon us. I mean, we're not just be thankful for the gift, but also for the giver. Thank you for the gift, but thank God for the giver. In the text, we're told that this brother came back praising God and knelt at the feet of Jesus, giving him thanks. Why did he do it? Because Jesus Christ is the ultimate source of our supply. It didn't come because I was so good. It came to me because God is good. He woke us up this morning. He clothed us in our right mind. The clothes that I have on came from him. My job, my resources, all of it came from God. He is the source of all my joy, my supply, everything I have, all that I am, and ever hope to be. I owe it all to him. I know that's simple. That's a simple truth, but come on. Some of y'all owe God. Some of us owe him. He brought us through surgery. Come on, somebody. He helped you raise them kids. Get them through college. Help me, somebody. Nobody did that but God. We got a bill we need to pay, and it's called praise. It's called worship. It's called thank you. If you got a hallelujah, God deserves it.
Yeah.
He's the ultimate.
Yeah.
Call.
Yeah. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think of the goodness of Jesus.
Yeah.
All he's done for me, my soul cries out. Hallelujah. Thank God. So a truly thankful heart is a thoughtful heart.
Yes, sir.
But then secondly, the text teaches that a truly thankful heart is an appreciative heart. Not only is it a thoughtful heart, but it's an appreciative heart.
All right.
This leper who came back, I believe he caught the spirit of David. David was thankful. He was grateful. One of his blessed Psalms, 103, he said, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that's within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul." And then he says, "Forget not all of his benefits." You know, because gratefulness and gratitude comes from an appreciation to God for his goodness to us. Has he been good to anybody in here? Gratefulness. My gratefulness. My gratitude comes from God's goodness, an appreciation for God's goodness for us. Now, you have to be careful because there are some appreciation killers. Those things, that element that causes us to be grateful. That I don't have time to list all of them, but let me just give you two of them. One of them is an appreciation killer is heartache, hardships, mess and misfortune, things that life sends our way. Those are appreciation killers. And I saw that because when the psalmist says, "Forget not all of his benefits," he was not saying that life is all benefits and blessings, because it's not.
Yeah. All right.
You know, the prosperity preachers will have us to know that if you experience trials, you ain't right with God, or you ain't got no faith. If you die, you ain't got no faith.
Yeah.
You're sick, your faith is weak. Come on, somebody.
Yeah. Yeah. My.
But life is not all blessings and benefits.
Right.
He said that he's suggesting that there are two columns in life. There are two columns. There's your credit column and there's your debit column. Life is full of credits and debits. He said, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that's within me. Bless his holy name." And then he says, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits."
Yeah.
And because he knows that sometimes we tend to focus more on the debit portion than the credit portion. He said, so don't forget his benefits. He said, I know you're catching hell. I know you're going through. But don't let your anchor, don't drop your anchor there. He's not saying that life is full of blessings. It's full of blessings. He said life is more than blessing. You know what debits are? Debits, you got a debit card. Debit is not what you put in the bank. Debit is what leaves you. Come on, somebody. The psalmist said because he knows we are prone to remember our hardships more than our benefits. We're prone to have pity parties and talk about our debits more than our credits. This man who came back shared. He had his share of hardships. He had heartaches. He had trials. He had tribulation. After all, he was a leper. He had a terminal disease. He was on his way out of here. He had his share of hardships and heartaches, trials and tribulation. He was a leper. He had a terminal illness. He was dying. It wasn't easy for him. And it's not easy for us. But here's what he said. Never allow your troubles to dull the edge of your appreciation. Paul said, in everything, give thanks. in good things, in bad things, when things are not going well. Never let my problem, never let my hardships, my misfortune, my heartaches dull the edge of my appreciation. I still got to thank God. I still got to be appreciative, not just thanking with my lips, but appreciative in my heart. Paul said, in everything give thanks. So this leper teaches us that no day is so dark. No problem is so hard. No failure is too fatal. No sickness is too complex. No experience is too crushing that causes us not to appreciate the goodness of God. Forget not all his benefits. Help me out, Brother Jones, Paul Jones. He says, I had some good days. I've had some bad days. I've had some hills to climb. I've had some lonely days and some lonely nights. But when I look around and I think things over, all of my good days outweigh my bad days. All of my credits outweigh my debits. I gain more than I lose. Help me, somebody. With God, I'm good. I'm rich in him. He said, all of my good days outweigh my bad days. I won't complain. Although my clouds hang low, I can hardly see the road. I asked the question, Lord, why so much pain? But he knows what's best for me. Although my weary eyes just can't see, so I made up my mind that I'm not going to forget his benefits. I'm going to say, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Can you say, thank you, Lord? I know I've got some debits. Help me, somebody. But I got some credits. If you mess with me, I start telling you about my credits. Help me, somebody. What the Lord has done for me. You ought to thank him for family, thank him for friends, thank him for a good church, a good pastor. I got more than I ever had. I got all kinds of blessings. And I got money in the bank. My bank account is solvent. I got a job. I woke up this morning, I got food on my table. I appreciate it. But before I leave that point, another appreciation killer is blessings. Help me, somebody. How many know blessings can literally kill our appreciation for God? Because the most unthankful people in the world, I've discovered, are those who have a greater reason to be thankful. The most folk who are bellyaching and moaning and groaning are those who have a greater reason to be thankful. When I was in Texas, I had an old preacher who kind of scooped me up, took me under his wing, and I was complaining to him about people talking about me. And I don't know what to do. They're not doing me right. And so he looked at me and said, are you still there? I said, yes, sir, I'm still here. He said, when they stop talking, you better get your hat. Come on, somebody. When you have a reason to be thankful. I think about the story of Dives and the rich man. It shows and Lazarus. Dives, the rich man, and Lazarus, the beggar, teaches us that it's easy to take your blessing for granted. We can be so blessed until we forget about praising and thanking God. I believe that's what happened to the other lepers. They took that blessing for granted. And you lose that appreciation for what God has done for you because you're so blessed until you don't know what to do with yourself. You've got all of this stuff that some of it you don't need. Help me, somebody. You got all this money. You won't give the Lord none of it. Help me, somebody. You're so blessed you don't know what to do with yourself, but it will kill and it will dull the edge of your appreciation. Let me throw this in and I'm gone. You may not remember, but you were probably more generous with your praise when you didn't have much of this world's good. Some folks stayed at the house of prayer, kneeling, falling out, rolling on the floor when they didn't have nothing. But now that they've been blessed, they're bourgeois, they can't hardly say amen. You gotta have a radar to see them coming to church. Help me, somebody. God can't bless everybody, because everybody can't stand to be blessed. Thankful hearted, a thoughtful hearted, an appreciative heart. In closing, thankful heart, truly thankful heart, is a humble heart. I'm out of here. The text says, the man who came and knelt at Jesus' feet, the man who came back, came and knelt at Jesus' feet, giving him thanks. And he was acknowledging, beloved, that healing, that the healing, the blessing that he received had come to him and not from him. I want you to notice how he came back. He came back kneeling. He came back humble. He came back praising. He came back worshiping. Humble. Praising, worshiping, came back with his humble heart, humble before God. I thought about the text that said, humble yourself under the mighty hand of God. He will exalt you in due season. He came back to worship. He came back showing us how to worship, how to come into the presence of God. Saints, isn't that what we do on any given Sunday? Anytime we come to church, we get a chance to come to the Lord's house. We come right. The church is not about us, you know that. But some of us come, some in Florida come like it's about them. Not here, I'm talking about elsewhere. But it's not a church. Worship is not about us. On any given Sunday, we come into the house of God. I mean, they bring everything to church now. Coke, Sprite, Gatorade. Come on, somebody. I got folk in my church that drink, that bring them a water bottle to church. They're drinking Zephyrillas. Ain't preached nothing. Ain't sung nothing. Hadn't even worshiped worth nothing, but got the nerve to turn up a bottle of water. We come into the house of God any kind of way now. Have I got a witness? We come dressed any kind of way. They got to throw some over us when we shout so our underwear won't show, or something else. We come into the house of the Lord any kind of way. Hey, but this leper, I'm out of here. This leper teaches us, new and afresh, how we ought to worship, how we ought to come into the presence of the Lord. Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely. You're altogether worthy. You're altogether wonderful to me. Have I got a witness? Paul said we ought to come right. We come as if we're here to receive something from God. So he teaches us how to come into the presence of God. So we can't sashay our way into the presence of the Lord. And I, just in case you're trying to wonder what that word sashay means, it means to strut and to move in an ostentatious and conspicuous manner. And then it adds moving sideways, a diagonal. Have I got a witness? Like you all that and a bag of chips. Just think in your mind, somebody sashaying that way into the presence of God. Have I got a witness? This leper reminds us that when we come into his presence, we ought to humble ourselves under the mighty hand of God. We ought to come with our heads down and not with our heads up. We ought to bow down and worship him, for he is worthy of worship. Have I got a witness? People come patting themselves on the back. But if God had intended for us to pat ourselves on the back, he would have made the joints of our arms differently. Have I got a witness? Ain't no way that comfortably I can pat myself on the back, because God didn't make me this way. In fact, I need to ask you, is it easier to pat yourself on the back or to bend your knees in the presence of God? Have I got a witness? I'm closing now. But I came to Jesus as I was weary, wounded, and sad. I found in him a resting place, and he has made me glad of all the things I've learned about worshiping God. I've learned how to come in his presence, how to come into the presence of God. He's worthy. I know he's a healer. I know he's a deliverer. I know he sets us free. But more than anything, God is holy. And Isaiah said, he's high and lifted up. His train filled the temple. His glory is everywhere. Thank the Lord. He's worthy. Anybody here know he's worthy? Joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that has made us.
Anybody here got a thankful heart? Come on, give God a great big thank you. Hallelujah. I want to extend the invitation to you today. You're here, you've never trusted Jesus as your Savior and Lord. You've never turned to him in faith and trust. Never said, Lord Jesus, come into my heart. I'm a sinner. I need your salvation. Tired of doing it my way. I want to do it your way. Surrender your life to him. If you're here today and you never trusted him as Lord and Savior, you can do that now. Yesterday you missed a chance. Tomorrow may be too late. Why not tonight? Don't wait tomorrow for what you can do today. I hear you talking. You said, Pastor, I can get myself, I'm gonna come when I get myself right. Well, if you could get yourself right, you wouldn't need to come. God says, come, wants you to come as you are, and what you ought to be, he'll make you that as you walk with him. So you come tonight trusting Christ as your personal Savior. As we sing, I'm inviting you to come, if you, whatever need. If you want to come back, to God, he's ready to hear you. He's ready to receive you. He's married to the backslider. We sing. As we sing, you come. God is calling you. You answer him today. Come.
Love.
we get ready to close, if you have a thankful heart, everybody stand on your feet. Let's give God praise. Praise for this messenger of God. Praise for the message from God. We've been blessed tonight. Please remain standing. I'm going to turn it back over to our evangelist to close it out tonight. I want to express appreciation on behalf of our GHIMF ministry to all the worship participants, to the praise dance ministry of Hopewell Missionary Baptist Church, to our Union Hill Primitive Baptist Church interpreting ministry. Let's give God praise for them. And again, we want to encourage you tonight. I know you've been blessed as I've been blessed. CDs and DVDs are available. You can stop in the foyer and get a copy of this service tonight. Encourage you to please leave tonight, call somebody, invite them to come with you tomorrow night. Encourage someone else to come and be blessed during these nights of service. Let's give God praise one more time for this messenger of God.
God bless you. Keep praying for me and for the revival, that the Lord will send a revival at the beginning of our hearts. And then while you're down there, lift the preacher's name up that I might gain strength every day to preach what God would have me to preach. Repeat after me. It is the whole duty of the whole church to preach the whole gospel to the whole world with our whole heart. God bless you. Tell somebody I love you and ain't a thing you can do about it.